Good afternoon. Hi. It's very exciting to be here. Hopefully we'll keep you awake as we go through the presentation. It was fun watching Steve and listening to Steve's talk as he hit on a lot of themes that I had already built into my PowerPoint. Of course, coming from a tech background, we've got to have slides, right? So first I want to start off with the theme of, you know, changing the world and leadership. And I decided that we really need to put our mindset in, you will change the world. Right, I just want that to sink in for a second. You will change the world. Right? Doesn't that feel different when you think about it that way? Not that you might, but you will. So I think that's a very important part of leadership and creating a positive vision for what you're going to do. And we're going to talk through some of that here today. Excuse me while I hit these. So this was a recent blog post, actually just a few weeks ago, by Seth Godin, who's a popular blogger, about the tragedy of small expectations. And expectations, as he says, you know, aren't guarantees. It doesn't mean it's going to happen. But if you don't have expectations, and strong positive expectations and aspirations, then you're not likely to achieve much, right? But you can't listen to the folks that say you can't do it. And I found that the bigger your aspiration and expectation, the more resistance you'll likely face. The more people that will tell you, you can't achieve that. Because you were born in the wrong country, or you came from the wrong family, or you don't have enough money, right? So don't listen to that, and make sure that you understand your vision, you set a vision for yourself and your path with strong expectations. And then others around you will follow you. Now, I came from a background that you would not predict necessarily much success. So I live in Cincinnati, Ohio, came from a large family that actually, on my mother's side, was Serbian. Three generations away. So three generations in the U.S. Big family, 36 cousins. Learned how to play Serbian music when I was a kid. Many musicians in our family that play all over the world. So just a little bit of a picture about my background. Most of my cousins did not go to college. Grew up Serbian Orthodox. My father was not Serbian. He didn't really know what he was. He had a mixed heritage. But he was a Vietnam War veteran and worked in steel mills and was an electrician. So he was a very technical person, but didn't go to college. And worked very hard, but didn't make a lot of money. And he was also an alcoholic. So he was also not always the best father. But he had good intentions, but he just did not know how to, he didn't know how to raise kids necessarily, right? But he wanted the best. We knew he wanted the best for us, but he didn't know how to provide it. And this was the environment that I grew up in. And I had an expectation, because I knew he had an expectation, that we would do better than he would. Right? That was the expectation that he had. He didn't know how we would do it, but that's what he wanted for his children. So I went to school in electrical engineering. So he was a techie, he was an electrician, I had good grades. I didn't know what I wanted to do when I grew up, but I knew that the world was going to be all about technology. And so I knew that if I had a degree in electrical engineering, I could probably do anything I wanted to do, right? So I didn't really worry about it when I was in college, about what am I going to do when I grow up. I just wanted to get that degree because I knew that would be the foundation of the future. Second thing I learned early on was how to combine my skill with my passion, which was music, as I explained. So I went to the dean of engineering school and said, you know, computers and music are starting to really come together. And he said, you're right. Let me introduce you to a professor at the Cleveland Institute of Music. And we started the first ever curriculum in computers and music and digital recording back in the mid-80s, which I thought, now I got excited. I wasn't excited about school before, but now I was excited because now I could see that what I was learning with electrical engineering could apply directly to my passion, which was music. And so I also like this from an entrepreneur standpoint because it represents a left brain and a right brain, which happens to be kind of my profile. So over the last 20-some years, I've been both an entrepreneur and, as Danny said, an investor, a VC, which I really enjoy because I get to invest in lots of different companies and working with very bright entrepreneurs that are changing the world, that are working on problems that some of us won't see for 10 or 20 years. And that, to me, was very exciting. I also had a small stint working on the presidential election in 2012. So that's a little bit of background on me. As I was doing the venture work, I did start to share this. Actually, it started in 2005. So I was an investor in a company that we sold to AOL for about $500 million. And I started seeing that the internet was becoming more people-oriented, right, instead of data-oriented. And I reached out to a professor at University of Illinois, Dr. David Goldberg, who was the world-renowned scientist in the area of computer optimization and genetic algorithms. He's literally the inventor of genetic algorithms. And we founded Share This. And it now reaches 700 million people a month across the globe. Headquarters is now in Palo Alto, California. We also have an office in LA and Chicago and New York, and have been growing very quickly. You probably see the icon all over the web as you're surfing. But I stayed in Cincinnati because my kids were in Cincinnati. We have three children. My wife Laura's here today as well, visiting Romania. The three kids are 23, 21, and 19. And I did not want to move them. So I made a choice at that point, which is I was going to stay in Cincinnati with our family, but we're going to make the headquarters for the company in Palo Alto. And when I did that, I moved from CEO to chairman. And we've helped them with their passions and mixing their skills and passions. So my son, who just graduated with a degree in aerospace engineering, has used that to go into the automotive industry to test cars, which he's super excited about and we're super excited about. And we're doing that with each of our kids. We found that figuring out what your passion is and then realizing that there really are no limits, that you can do anything you want at any age, as long as you put the effort into it, will take you very far. And so they've done some incredible things because we've had that attitude. So in addition to Share This, I'm also working on this thing called Centrifuge. Centrifuge is interesting because it was a nonprofit started by all the big companies in Cincinnati, Ohio. The biggest one that you probably know is Procter & Gamble. They came together and said, we need more venture-backed startups in Cincinnati. Cincinnati is a city of about 2 million people. And they asked me to run a fund, which is about $60 million, and we invest in other early-stage venture funds, and we work with all the accelerators and startups in Cincinnati. The one that's best known in the U.S. is Brandery. Brandery's been ranked in the top 10 accelerators in the last 6 years. And they have candidates come from all over the world for the Brandery. And we're building this tech community in Cincinnati. We've invested in 10 funds from TechStars, if you've heard of TechStars in Boulder, Colorado, to Lear Ventures, to Upfront Ventures in L.A. 10 funds that represent about $2 billion. That we're tying into Cincinnati. And it's really exciting. We're here talking with Don Lothrop to some of his friends here in Romania about how that could apply here as well. So there's some learnings I'm gonna take from this and apply later in the presentation. So that's a little bit of background. So back to You Will Change the World. Now that we've decided that's true, the question is how? Right? How are you gonna change the world? And given what's going on, I may have a sense for how that's going to take place. And you know, the first thing is, obviously, and Steve mentioned it, you know, technology is in your favor, right? We've seen unprecedented amount of access to technology from telecommunications, which in the last 20 years has developed and allowed countries to leapfrog, you know, from wireline communications to wireless and mobile, and the cloud. So some of you may have heard, Mark Andreessen, right? He is known for saying, you know, software is eating the world. I think it was 2011, right? Basically, software is just taking over everything and disrupting industries. Well, that's actually been updated recently, and it is mobile's taken over, is eating the world, right? So your future as a leader and the way you're going to change the world is likely going to be through mobile, right? We're in a very much a mobile-first world, so you need to be thinking about that. So if you want to learn more about this, I'm going to pull some comments from his partner, Benedict Evans, who has a presentation. You can go on SlideShare if you want and see this presentation on Mobile is Eating the World. And he talks about all the ways that mobile is changing the landscape of technology and the internet itself and all of our attention. All right, so I'm going to hit a couple of those highlights. One, this is a graph showing the growth of smartphones versus PCs, right? Huge amount of growth in mobile technology. Matter of fact, the iPhone 6, just the weekend that iPhone 6 launched, there are 25 times more transistors, CPU transistors, than there were in all of Earth in 1995, just on the one weekend. So the explosion of technology and accessibility of technology is unprecedented. And there are people, like Steve said, sitting on hay carts with horses on their phones, right? So it's not just the privilege. The cost of these phones have come down. The lowest cost smartphone from Samsung is $35, right? So anybody can have it. So the prediction is by 2020, 80% of adults will have smartphones, right? Right now in the U.S., over half the time you spend online is done on your smartphone. Probably not too different here. And the power of that smartphone, 625 times more powerful than a 1995 Pentium computer. So that has dramatic effects on the way the world operates at this point. Because of that, that's also transformed this market for apps, all the apps that you run on your phone. People are saying, you know, this is now the appization of the economy. The web is dead. We're in a post-web world. It's now about the apps. So this year it's expected to be almost 36 billion, or over 36 billion spent on and through apps on mobile phones. Okay, so it's a huge, huge shift. So think about it. By 2020, there'll be 2 to 3 times more smartphones than computers. And smartphones are actually a lot more capable of a lot of different things than computers are. Right? We don't think of it that way, but they really are. When you think about all the location data we get with our phones, with sensors that can be on your phone to measure what you're doing, measure your health, record all your transactions and your payments. So the opportunity on mobile is extraordinary. So now you know why you're going to change the world with mobile. Part of what's happening with mobile is there's this pendulum swinging, a shift that's happening. So when you look back in the computer industry, it started out with mainframes and dumb terminals, right? All the intelligence was on the mainframe. And then PCs came along. And then we had things like client-server architecture, which meant more logic was pushed out to the PC, right? And we weren't as dependent on a mainframe. Then the web comes along with the thin client, excuse me, and now you have web servers and data centers, and you have a thin client again, kind of like the mainframe days. Well, now it's swinging back from the browsers back to the mobile phone because we have all this power and capability in the mobile phone. And meanwhile, we have data centers. Amazon can't build them fast enough all over the world that are draining power and create enormous amounts of heat. And so how can we take advantage of this huge inventory of mobile phones that everybody's carrying around with them to do more? So there's a shift that's happening right now to change the way apps are developed. Some of you may have heard of an app development platform called Meteor. Andreessen invested in this company. The reason they invest in this company is because they understand this. And the core of their technology is built on a notion of data on the wire, which means they're no longer sending a bunch of HTML code to the client. They're just sending the data about the state of the application. If you're playing a game, they're just sending a position data about your character or your chess piece or what have you. So it's radically changing the way developers are able to develop, and it's making it a lot easier. So they're replacing all of this code and logic that you had to develop before for a mobile device to keep track of the client-side data and what's happening with the user interface. Matter of fact, they have something really interesting. You see there it says speculative client-side updates. They have this term called optimistic UI, which I think is really cool. It's like, how can the user interface be optimistic? It's optimistic because it's anticipating what it thinks the state of your application is on your phone, and it makes it that until it gets data that says otherwise, which makes everything faster. So very cool. I'd encourage you to, if you're a techie, I'd encourage you to look at it, check it out. It's also really interesting because it works for both experts and novices. So you can get started with Meteor, and it also has the tools and the power if you're a hardcore developer. So we're seeing a lot of this with the startups in the US, and I think this is a major trend that you should be paying attention to if you're going to be a tech entrepreneur. The next trend is the collaborative economy, right? Some of you may have seen this. So industries are being transformed every day by the collaborative economy, right? And if you look at what's going on here, what's in common with all these companies? They don't own any assets, right? Uber doesn't own any taxi cars, right? Facebook doesn't own any content. Airbnb doesn't own any real estate, right? Yet they're totally disrupting the industry. So that's a dramatic shift in the way industries operate. This is a collaborative economy chart that a guy named Jeremiah Ouyang created. He's a consultant that has been making his living talking about collaborative economy. And what you see here is there's literally not an industry that hasn't been touched by the collaborative economy, by startups who are developing mobile apps like Uber that can dramatically change industry. Now, one of those industries also relates, if you're a leader, tech startup, entrepreneur, and you want to get funding, that area has been impacted by the collaborative economy as well. It's called crowdfunding. How many have heard of crowdfunding, crowdsourcing? Just about everybody. Good. I was afraid of this. I was going to come here and everybody's going to know all this already. So there's a number of different programs that you can go to, you know, whether you're doing project-based funding or you want to get equity crowdfunding. Two of the ones I want to talk about here are AngelList and OurCrowd. Matter of fact, AngelList, I did a lookup, and it looks like there's 382 companies from Romania that have been listed on AngelList. Now, I don't know if they've all raised money, but they're at least on AngelList. And this is a very important phenomenon. Not only does it mean that you can get access to this money for investors in your company, but it means you can create a network of customers, a network of partners, a network of test users, right? So it really is a great platform for marketing your company and finding partners on a global scale. So it doesn't matter where you are. You can find them anywhere. AngelList is differentiated in that it's an open marketplace, so it's ad hoc. You go out there and investors find you. Well, what they've done that's unique is they've created the idea of syndicates. Syndicate is a word that's used to mean investors come together, basically, right? And people can follow other angel investors. So if I'm an investor on AngelList and I'm investing in a startup, other investors might want to invest in that startup too because they think I know what I'm doing, maybe. So these syndicates are really powerful because you can put them together to raise larger amounts of funds, right? So it's even if you don't raise money on AngelList, if you're a startup, I encourage all startups to make sure they have a profile on AngelList for marketing purposes. The next one is called OurCrowd, and this comes from John Medved in Israel, but it's also now global. Both of these platforms, by the way, have helped companies raise over $100 million last year. OurCrowd is a little bit more like a venture firm in that they will source the startups, they will do the due diligence, they will write it up. So it's not as ad hoc as AngelList is, and it's a more accredited investor base, so more qualified investors. The result of that is the average investment on OurCrowd raises $1.2 million. So they raise a lot more than AngelList does. But it's not necessarily as broad. So these are the two that I pay attention to now and I recommend to entrepreneurs. Okay, so that's some of the tech shift, collaborative economy, how you're going to get funding. Let's talk a little bit about company building and a couple book recommendations because we're not going to be able to cover everything today, so I want to give you some other ideas of things you might want to go read. And one is Chip Conley. Chip was the founder of second largest boutique hotel chain in the US. And now he's the senior VP of hospitality for Airbnb. Okay? And he's written several books. Peak, I really like. And what he has done is he's taken Maslow's hierarchy of needs, if you're familiar with that, and he's used it as a planning tool for companies. Okay, and I'll walk you through some of this. So we've used this at ShareThis. So there's a series of pyramids here. One is the employee and company pyramid. Okay, and just like in Maslow's hierarchy of needs, If you look at employees, what do employees need? Well, first they need the base motivation. Just like Maslow says, you need, you know, your physiological needs, food and water. You need to get paid, right? People expect you to get paid. Next level is recognition. Once you recognize people on your team and you give recognition for their contributions, you create loyalty with your team, right? But ultimately, to really be successful, you want to create meaning in your work. And meaning is what drives the inspiration of your team to do more, to work harder, to challenge each other. So this is an important stack for your culture of your company. Once you have that, then you can look at what that group is going to do, what that team is going to do for your customers. In the same way, at a base level, you want to meet the customer expectations, right? And historically, the last 20 years or so, companies would do these satisfaction surveys. But they found that those aren't necessarily helpful because people want more than just to be satisfied. So a common example is if you're asked that you go to buy a, let's say you buy a car or you go to a hotel and they give you a little survey and say, would you please rank me on a scale of 1 to 10? How well did I do? By the way, my bonus depends on this, so give me a 10. The result is you're not really getting good input, right? You're just helping that person in their job, which is great, but you're not really giving the company what they really want, which is good input in terms of how good was their product or service. So we have to do better than that. And if you really help the company or the customer meet their goals, you create strong commitment, which means you can lock in commitment and revenue and longer-term contracts with your customers. But what we really want to do, if you're doing a startup and you're trying to create the next market leader, is you want to unlock their unrecognized needs. You want to do something because you understand their business so well that you've just totally changed their business in a way they didn't even expect. And that creates evangelism. Evangelism creates more customers. They go out and tell others, you wouldn't believe what this startup has done for me. It's completely changed the way we make reservations in our hotel. So, and as most venture-backed startups, that's what we want to achieve, right? It's not good enough just to be generating satisfactory results like everybody else, right? We're looking for dramatic change to business. And finally, this last pyramid is the investor pyramid, investor truth. And investors start with first building trust, right? You want to make sure that they understand that you are spending your money wisely, that you're reporting back to them, that you're being honest and transparent. As you go up, you build more a stronger bond and relationship with the investor. But ultimately, what you want is to build a legacy. The investors are investing in your company because they believe in you and because they believe in what your vision is, right? And so that's what's so interesting about these crowdsource programs. These are people that are saying, look, I love what you're doing. I want to be a part of it. It's their way to participate in that success and that legacy. And that, again, turns into evangelism and pride of ownership on behalf of the investors. So this is what you want, to have your company surrounded with this framework, which creates a virtuous cycle for the company. You have a unique corporate culture that's energized, that's building enthusiastic staff, making customers very loyal, producing hopefully profits and growth, and that is the cycle that we want to get into. So leaders make the future, right? If anybody's read any Malcolm Gladwell books, you know, the first part of this is about reimagining the world. We just talked about this. Take mobile, take collaborative economy, and how can you reimagine the world? How can you reimagine the way you go back and forth to work or to school? How can you reimagine the way you learn, right? It starts with that kind of imagination. And what I found, by the way, with many, if not every entrepreneur that I've seen that's had a successful company, there also is a David and Goliath moment. That is, there's a point when they take on the system, where you take on a union, you take on the incumbent, the major, the leader in the market. And so you're preparing for that. As you're building your startup, I think you're preparing for that day when you're gonna totally transform a market. And that's that David and Goliath moment. And starts by, this is something that Josh Lerner has in one of his latest books, The Difference Between Having a Fixed Mindset and a Growth Mindset. And I love this. This is saying, how can I do things and learn as I do them? Companies don't grow unless the CEO is growing. You know, just as Steve was saying, you can't go run several countries and then come in and run Romania, right? All these leaders are learning. We're all learning. And the employees underneath you want to see that you're learning. If you're learning and growing, they will learn and grow. So you need to have this growth mindset versus this fixed mindset. The fixed mindset says, I just do things to be safe. I do things so I know I can get straight A's, right? Because I want to look good. So if you think about what that, the implications of that, right? The fixed mindset says they want to avoid challenges. The growth mindset says, I want to embrace them. Fixed mindset says, I'm going to give up in obstacles. Growth says, I want to persist in obstacles, et cetera, right? So some of you probably are on this, on the right side, on the growth mindset, I would imagine, or you wouldn't be here, right? But for me, this was a very helpful way to think about how you take on problems. Because again, if you're going to run a company, if you're going to start a startup, you will be learning constantly. And you're going to have the courage to grow and face problems that you've never faced before. Another recommendation here, John Maxwell's 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. And it really sums up in that, you know, leadership is influence. So once you've reimagined the world, now it's time to convince your founders to join you, to quit their jobs. It's time to convince your friends and families to invest. It's time to convince strangers to invest, right? It's time to convince customers to join you, to buy your product. So at the end of the day, it's all about influence, right? How well you communicate your vision, how passionate you are about your vision, and how well you execute against that. So at the sum, leadership's about influence. And if you look behind you and there are people behind you, you're leading. If you look behind you and you don't have anybody behind you, then maybe you're not influencing, right? So you need to check that every once in a while. Have friends and advisors to help you understand when you might be off track. So the way I would sum this up in terms of those skills, first of all, you know, reimagine the world, right? Look at what is available to you in terms of the technology that we have today. Look at what's happening with the collaborative economy, and how can you imagine your marketplace or the world or your country? Second, imagine the vision, a positive vision of victory, right? Of the end goal, which is winning. Ultimately, you got to start with the end and figure out how to work towards it, right? Do not pat yourself on the back with what I'll call vanity metrics. Hey, we've grown the company 20% week over week. Isn't that great? Yeah, you've gone from generating $1,000 a week to $1,200 a week. So what? Like, you haven't made a dent in the universe yet. Start with the end goal. If you're going to transform a market, you need to be a $100 million company, right? And how are you going to get there in your lifetime? How will that happen? So start envisioning that and working towards that in a reasonable time frame. And finally, if it's growing, you're producing growth, you know you're on the right track. And whether this relates to business or fundraising for a campaign, growth is the number one metric. You look at Amazon. Amazon has lost money for years, but they continue to grow, and so investors continue to support them, right? Studies have shown growth is the only metric that really matters. So, and what that signifies is taking over a market, right? When you take over a market, you're going to be growing, assuming the market's growing, or assuming you're taking out the competition or the incumbents. So, look behind you, see if the growth is happening. If it's not happening, you have to go back and look at your strategy. All right, so hopefully those are some helpful thoughts, helpful lessons that I can share from my experience. Any questions? Yeah. Right. Hopefully the world will take over Silicon Valley, right? We don't want to try to replicate. It's hard to replicate what Silicon Valley's done. This is what T-shirt I'm wearing, by the way. Startup Cincy, hashtag Startup Cincy, is the movement we have with Centrifuge in Cincinnati, right? Whether it's Cincinnati, whether it's London, you have to have all the right components. But the thing is, right now, everything's accessible. We're not limited by geography anymore, right? We have access to the money. We have access to the people and advisors. The reason I didn't leave Cincinnati is because I wanted to live in Cincinnati. I didn't want to live in Silicon Valley, right? So I think it is possible. And I think there are many regions in the world that have the potential for that kind of growth. It takes the mixture of the money and of talent, education, to come together to create that unique thing that is Silicon Valley. One of the things that we noticed in Cincinnati is it relates to growth, right? We have 200 and some startups in Cincinnati. And when I look at all those startups, I say, how many of those people in those startups have been part of companies that have been part of growth, who've gone from 0 to 10 million in revenue? It's probably a low number. So they don't even know what it looks like, right? You go to Silicon Valley, if you haven't been part of it, your neighbors probably have and your friends have. So you have others around you that can give you input and say, here's how you grow. Here's what growth looks like, right? And so if there are centers in the world like London where there are more people that are experienced entrepreneurs that are helping to provide that advice and mentoring to the new entrepreneurs, then I think it will produce that kind of growth. But historically, Silicon Valley had that and it was a geographic density. But now that technology is taking away the limits of geography, I think it can happen anywhere.
In your opinion, which are the main things that lead a business to success?
The main thing? Oh, that's easy. What are the main things lead a business? It first starts with a big vision, right? If you don't have a big enough vision, nothing else matters. It really needs to start there. And then it's the right people. And the people that are talented enough that have experience with growth, who have experience in whatever those things are that you need, whether it's development or marketing or what have you. It's about getting the right people after that, which includes your investors. So it's vision and people. And if you go out and you share your vision with others and you see them get excited, then you know you're on the right track. If you're not getting that feedback about your vision, then you have to look at it honestly and say, well, maybe my vision's not quite right. Maybe I'm not communicating it well. Maybe it's not big enough. So I look at those two things.
How was your first meeting with your first investor? How did it went, and mostly from where did you get the push to go to?
So you don't have the proof. It went great because I raised a bunch of money. again, they have to believe in the vision. So when I started to share this, for example, I said, look, the internet is inundated with information. We have more information than we can ever possibly absorb. The way to filter through that information is based on information that people share. Sharing creates the filter for all that information. And at first, people looked at me like they didn't know what I was talking about. And then I started getting data. So I started getting more data to prove the point. And one of the proof points was I'd ask people, how many times do you share links with your friends or receive links? And they said, many times a day. But I could not find any organization in the world that measured that. Nobody knew how many times a day. And just that, just knowing that nobody knows that information was pretty interesting. Well, what if we could know that information? What could we do then? So that's how it started. So I think you're constantly, if your vision's big enough, you're never done delivering on it. You know, we're not done with Share This by any means. You're always building towards it. That tells you that you have a big enough vision. Yep.
So which was your biggest failure, and how did you get over it?
Oh, well, current ones or the... So I actually, the first company was, we're actually in my basement and hired programmers and spent basically all of our savings. But I ultimately wanted to get into venture capital, and so I was trying to raise money for this startup. It was based on some technology from Oracle, invested all our savings in it, found out that the Oracle technology was vaporware. It didn't it was never gonna be real. So I basically was gonna have to start over. But in the process of starting the company, I met different venture capitalists, and they asked me to join them. So it was a failure. The company never really got too far off the ground, but it turned into an awesome career opportunity. So, and I think that's back to the growth mindset. You have to look at the failures as learning opportunities, right? What did you? And if you don't reflect on what the learning opportunity is, then it really is a failure.
Well, oftentimes people do have their dreams and whatever they want to do, but they can't find the opportunity to do that. Well, do you think that one can actually create that opportunity for themselves? And if so, how can they do that, especially if they come from a background of, let's say, I don't know, they're underprivileged, or they don't have money, or they don't have the knowledge or opportunities in terms of education? Is that even possible if you start from a lower boundary than
Absolutely possible. So, that's basically where I was starting from. The leadership is influence, I think, is the key there. If you know what you're talking about, if you've done your homework, if you are a leader who's communicating that vision and can find others that want to follow you, I think you'll be successful. And you can reach out and find those people all over the world. There was a young guy who came to me a few years ago. He was just in high school. And he tried an experiment. He tried to build a social networking platform on top of LinkedIn. And it failed. But he put it out there and was trying to do it. And he had all these followers. And some of them were VCs and other entrepreneurs. And it was pretty interesting. And he went and followed up with those people, including me. And every meeting he'd have, he'd say, well, do you have three other people that you could introduce me to that could help me to do what I was doing? And before you know it, he now runs a conference. He started a conference while he was still in high school that had hundreds of people showing up in Silicon Valley, you know, teaching him about innovation and entrepreneurship. And just because he started reaching out and people liked him. They believed in what he was trying to do, right? So you need to get people to follow you. You need to get people that want to help you achieve that vision and make some. And ultimately, if the vision needs to be more about than just you, right? If it's something that people can share and buy into, that they can see their version of your vision, that's better. One more? Go ahead.
Okay. So let's say someone comes to you with a new project or with a new company or the new thing, and let's say it is in the same domain you're also interested in and you're professing in, let's say. How would you respond to new challenges like this? Will you invest in this sort of thing, or I don't know, if this person gives you all the arguments, all you need to know, and it is a good deal, as a good project, how would you respond to that?
As a venture capitalist, you're saying, or as an entrepreneur?
Yeah. As an entrepreneur, actually.
Okay, so how would I respond to somebody who has a good idea that could be competitive? Ah, that's what you're getting. Okay. So I've had a lot of that. And the first thing that I think is important on that is to know that if you heard the expression ideas are a dime a dozen, it's kind of easy to have ideas. It's a lot harder to actually do it. So I've seen thousands and thousands and thousands of business plans and ideas that you may tell me right now you have an idea that's going to make my company obsolete. I used to get nervous about that, and I used to see, matter of fact, I remember seeing press releases when I was starting Share This of Google employees starting something that was going to be competitive, and I would worry about it all week and all weekend. I'd worry about it, and it was just a press release. After two or three weeks, it just went away. They never were able to do it, right? So there's a big difference between having an idea and actually executing it. Now, if you came back to me and started showing me growth metrics, now we might talk, right, and figure out a way to partner. But until I see the growth, it's just an idea. Okay, thank you.